So this is invariant under K on the right side, and this is invariant under K on both sides. So if you take this, then this gets the which is this here. So
suppose if this is a function of g1, you have a function of g1, so you just want k in there, so you put a k here and in g2, right? Then here if you put k1 g1 and k2 on this side, then so this actually becomes by k. Okay, so
one again. First thing is f of e is your small f of g, right? Because if you put e here and then k, you get rid of a on this side, and this becomes small f of g. And this is non-zero, we know that. So here you have started with f small f by k invariant, but this is a usual trick. When you don't have invariance, you can get a k invariance in this room. Here you have both small f and capital F by k by n. So this similar trick will also be used when we go from k by invariant to g by k. There. So f of e is non-zero, that is what we have, and f is k by invariant, that is again easy to see. Okay, so like I was telling, the k1 and k2 here, you can get rid of k2, and k1 if you put here, k1 goes to k, that transformation. So then you get this. Now, so this capital F at E, you can write as here. So you can use this to write capital F hat at lambda, delta to be pi lambda by 2 t lambda of this weight, and this is nothing but small f at g. So in order to get small f of g, what do you need to get is just calculate capital F. Okay? If you can calculate capital F at lambda in terms of small f at lambda, that is what you will get this result. Okay, so it will turn out to be just this. Okay, so let's do that. So f at lambda is by definition it's g1. This is the definition of f at lambda. Now I want to introduce k into the picture. So I first use the definition of capital F, which is given here. So now I take a change of variable. I take g1 to k inverse g1. Okay. So this becomes gg1. Okay. And this, for this I have for g1 goes to k inverse g1. But we know that phi lambda is pi invariant. So I can get rid of the k inverse. So this I now again get rid of the k integral. So get this f g g 1 phi lambda g 1 d g 1. Okay, and make another change of variable. I take g g 1 to g 1. Okay, so just into that, I get this is my g 1. The lambda is now g inverse g1, right? D g1. So I do the change of variable g1 for you to g1. This thing. Okay? Okay. Now I want to introduce again k into the picture. So I just write k here, f k g1 anyway it is k by a period. So this k doesn't matter. I that integral can come out and this is the integral 1. And I have this 1. Again I take a change of variable. Now I take a change of variable a g1 goes to g1. I want to put this k inside the field lambda and then use the formula in 2 here. Okay. So this is f of g1, a g1 goes to g1, and the integral of k comes here. And so I can change first k g1. Dk here and dg1 outside. This is the table. Okay. Okay. So now here. So now I can use the functional equations which I had proved yesterday. So maybe I just recall them here. I'll just recall here. I can write this as I'm not using this one, I'm using the other one, previous one. I'm using this k by dk, this is phi lambda x, phi lambda y. So if you have a k inside two variables and you integrate it out, you just get it as multiple. So here, same thing you do here, t versus h, 1 is there, k is inside, integrate it out, so you get f of g1, p lambda g inverse, p lambda g1, right? So all the factors of g1 are inside, but this one does not depend on g1 anymore, but it out. So the whatever remains is f, integral of f g1, p lambda g1, t g1. It's just f at lambda, right? So f at lambda, p lambda, that is what you want to prove. So this proves how to come from this theorem from here. So from the immersion, from the value of the function at the point D, how to come to value of the function at the point G. Okay. So this variation is immersion. I stated this yesterday, but not proof. So today we'll go to Langschler. That I need some more things. So you've already seen convolution. Okay, there are several ways to define convolution. So maybe which one I think, but anyway, so suppose this is the definition of convolution. So here I need some facts. For example, for me, the functions are CC infinity, right? So I need the fact that if you convolve two CC infinity functions, I will get another CC infinity function. Okay. So convolution is sort of a smoothing operator. So if you have some differentiability even on one of them, and if you don't have on the other, then the resulting thing is quite smooth. Smoothness goes across to the convolution. So here if you have smoothness on both, then you will have the f when g are smooth, then f star g is smooth, and also compactly supported. Similarly, both are compactly supported, then also g is compactly supported. So I need that. So let me just write it down. Okay. So yes, first I will use one
solution to go from inversion to plancha. Okay?
So in order to prove plancha, I need some results regarding convolution.
So the usual
result in convolution which we see in the Fourier series or Fourier transform, that if you take a convolution of two functions and take the Fourier transform, it's a product of the Fourier transform of each. Okay, so that holds here also, that's my next result. So if f g I c is infinity of and by the gradient, then I have this I can write up put here, right? No problem. F star g half of lambda equal to visible, right? Okay, so this holds. So then we use this. So basically this use what will be some like what it has been here, some change of variable and maybe the functional variable. Okay. So anyway, let's see the proof. So f star g hat of lambda, that is by definition f star g of x g and phi lambda x dx. That's the definition. And phi lambda, I know because of all the nice properties, I can do whenever I can one, I can put them inverse there because they are same. So I just put them inverse. Now, if I just, open it up, I get, so if I open the definition up, I see here this one, now this one, f x y inverse g y. Okay, so hey, all of these just come from g w. So I can write integral of g y here, and the thing inside will be f of x y inverse and phi lambda of x inverse dx and d y outside, right?
Scalars.
t, we won't have that, right? Unless t is available.
No, I am just asking, is there a way to descend to the quotient?
Yes. Sure.
I
maybe I speak this proof because just write the expression of d lambda e to the power I lambda. So that you can write as e to the power minus I lambda, I of minus lambda. So plus 1 of h of the inverse I messed up x and this x. So this you can write as this is same as phi of minus lambda x from the definition, and phi of minus lambda x is phi of lambda x. You lose to get this. Okay. So this is only when lambda is real. Okay? That's because the conjugation that is used in the conjugation. But now we can go to Blanchard for k by k. And using that, we can prove both inversion and transfer for functions on G. So, if x is in CC, is it okay to get proof for the problem? So please stop me if you are not following something. Convolution of two such C infinity.
functions are in CC.
This is what I say. Okay, so we need this. Now, so basically what we'll do is we want to get this on both sides. I'll calculate, I'll calculate the Fourier transform of this and then sum of it. That's a very standard way. So first, let me calculate.
So your lambda is in R, right? So for lambda in R, I can calculate the Fourier transform of F, I mean spherical Fourier transform of F bar, which is but we put fx bar here and lambda x dx.
And just now we have seen that phi lambda x is same as in phi lambda x bar. So you can put a bar here and this is easy. This is nothing but fx
lambda.
Okay.
And so if you want to calculate the Fourier transform of the convolution, it is just f at lambda into f at lambda bar, the product of these two. So it is just mod f at lambda square. Okay? And similarly, if you just look at the convolution of these two at the point E, and just apply the definition of convolution. Okay, so if you apply the definition of convolution, you get f of x inverse, f of x bar, right? That's the definition of f bar. And dx. So you get this, but you already know that for k by many functions, inverse doesn't matter. I can get rid of this. Okay, so this is nothing but the L2 one of. Okay, and now, so what you want to do, you want to get, so you have got the L2 norm, you want to get this on the right hand side, and where you know that this thing is, it comes from this F star by F bar, right? So now you can use this formula. What is this? This is the inversion formula, the first one, I mean the one at E. Okay. So I derive today, right? From the one at E to the one at G. So I just use the one at E to get it here and that. So this gives you Plancherel for k by many functions. So now what is left? That we wanted to do Plancherel on functions on g by k, right? So we have to get back from, so we have to get rid of one k invariance, right? Yeah, g by k is k invariance on the right. Here I have for both sides k invariance, I have to get rid of the left k invariance. And so now we need that. So, as I told you, this is stated for CC infinity and proved for that, but it extends to, I mean, since it's an isometry, it extends from L2 of g by k to enter the space. So now now I need one more result. I hope so. Take these g1. Okay, so this you have, and
whatever is remaining
is the minus minus I of the plus 1, h of g minus k. So here of that, here you have not started with f by k variant. Okay, you have only started with f, which is k variant on the right k. Okay, so but this turns out to be by k. So again, see f1 of if you write k1, h, k2, if it just goes inside and just write down k. You have the page values on the right, you can get rid of this, and this two you can love the high measure of the and then you can get a here. So it is nothing but h. Okay. So that is what I was the trick I was talking about, that even if you don't have k invariance, you can generate it back like that. So you put the k somewhere and indeed, depending on which size invariance you want, you put the k on. Okay. So yeah, so this is so this f1 becomes 5k invariance now. So we can write that this f1 is in CC and k by invariance here, and also we have f1 of to be equal to what is f1 of e? You just put e here. So you get F G A T K, right? And what is F? F is of invariant, it's invariant, or right invariant with respect to K. So you, this is just F G. Okay, so and use this K and then. Okay, so this is F1 of E. Now, if you calculate F1 at lambda, gain gradient on t, and now we need the flangular again. So for the flangular, you did flangular also. To this, then we have to use this test.
Minus x1.
then outside you have here, outside you have right? And then, so this was, remember? Now, remember this was nothing but the expression for f. This was the inversion working. Okay. So whatever we have here is just the inversion working. I have missed some b, right? B like that. Okay. Yeah. So you get g bar, and the one inside the bracket is just f g.
Thank you.